Before the launch of AMD's new AM4 platform and their line of Ryzen 3, 5, and 7 desktop processors, one of the strongest arguments for buying one of the older AM3-based chips was if you were planning to build a home theater PC, or a small form factor system with low power requirements. This would allow you to use one of their pile driver-based APUs, a CPU with integrated graphics, as they generally were seen as superior to Intel's HD graphics line when it came to gaming. Well, fast forward some number of years now, and we have a new release from AMD and two new entries into their APU lineup, this time taking advantage of their Vega GPU technology fused with first generation Ryzen CPUs. Unfortunately, AMD chose not to sample us this time around, but fear not, we got something better instead. Last week, I posted a video that got some pretty good feedback from the community and talked about pre-built desktops and how right now they're a better value than a DIY solution. The system I featured there was from Computer Upgrade King. And once again, we're going to be working with their builds for this video. This system right here is the main attraction, the Axiom. Inside this slick little box, you can configure the B350 or A320 motherboard to house either the new Ryzen 3 2200G or the Ryzen 5 2400G. Now, while the Axiom case is too small to fit any normal size GPU, the fact that our CPU now sports a Vega graphics package means that for home theater use or maybe some light 1080p gaming, hopefully we won't need one. So let's talk a little bit more about the new APUs. The Ryzen 3 2200G is launching at the same MSRP as the existing Ryzen 3 1200, and that's just $99. Compared to the 1200, the 2200G offers significantly higher clock speeds, better memory support, and either the same or lower TDP, depending if you're using discrete graphics or not. The biggest shortcoming is the reduction in PCIe lanes for graphics cards from 16 to 8, but this is more of a reallocation than a subtraction, as the CPU is now talking to the integrated Vega GPU instead. That Vega GPU sports 8 compute units and 512 stream processors and runs at 1100 MHz out of the box. Similarly, the Ryzen 5 2400G sees the same bump in clock speed over the existing Ryzen 5 1400, the same improved memory support, and the same reduction in PCIe lanes, although the price does bump up from $149 for the 1400 to $169. To compensate, however, you do get SMT enabled for 8 logical cores, and a better GPU included as we move up to 11 compute units and 704 stream processors, with a clock speed of 1250 MHz. Both new chips come with AMD's excellent Wraith Stealth cooler in the box, which provides more than enough cooling capacity, and even allows for some slight overclocking. That would be overclocking of the CPU cores, but also of the GPU cores. You can overclock the Vega cores in these APUs just like you would a normal discrete graphics solution. But just know that as with all overclocks, your mileage may vary, and depending on how far you're pushing things, you might want to look into an aftermarket cooler. Maybe one of the best parts about what AMD is doing here is that they're committed to the AM4 socket for at least the next couple of years, meaning that if you already own an AM4 board, a simple BIOS flash will allow you to run these new processors. Just be sure that your motherboard has video outputs if you want to take advantage of the iGPU. When we look at the specs of these chips, they match or exceed the RX 550, AMD's low-end esports-focused GPUs. The RX 550 boasts 8 compute units and only 512 stream processors, but it does bring to the table its own dedicated memory, whereas the Ryzen APUs have to share with system memory. This is definitely something to consider when configuring your build, and I ran into some really interesting results when doing my testing. The Axiom shipped with a single 8GB stick of DDR4 installed. I ran my first round of testing with the R5 2400G and emerged with some really unimpressive results. I decided that I wanted to see just how much the memory configuration influences graphics performance, seeing as the system memory is serving as the frame buffer. And wouldn't you know it, Swapping out the single DIMM for a dual channel kit saw our scores increase anywhere from 16 to 93% with no other modifications made to any other component or testing method. It was for this reason that I decided that I should run all of the rest of my testing with a dual channel 16 gigabyte memory setup. Now, before we get to our results, I want to talk a bit about why we have this other system here, the Switch 77. This is an Intel-based system and was configured to compete with the AMD-equipped Axiom from a performance standpoint, although clearly the form factor is slightly different. It features a Z370 setup with an i3-8100 along with an NVIDIA GT 1030. Computer Upgrade King also sent along an i5-8400, but we'll be sticking to the budget comparison for now. Even with the 8100 and a completely no-frills build, you're likely still looking at around a $600 cost here, far more than our AMD system, which you can get for about $430. So let's load these two systems up with games and see how they fare. Synthetic data drawn from programs like FireStrike and Cinebench are good markers of overall performance and a good way to directly compare CPU or GPU solutions. However, they tell us little about real-world gaming experience. In titles like Metro Last Light and Rise of the Tomb Raider, the APUs were not able to deliver playable frame rates, even without the settings cranked all the way up. Overwatch was slightly better, and given how that game plays, we can call 41 frames per second borderline playable, as long as you're completely fine with being pretty casual. Turn down the settings a bit from Ultra, and I think you're probably good to go. CSGO provided a fine experience between 60 and 80 frames per second, and even though I've had some esports snobs scoff at me for calling this a playable range for this game, this is indeed playable. The vast majority of people do not own monitors with a refresh rate higher than 60 Hz anyway, and anyone who is gaming with an APU certainly hasn't invested in a 240 Hz display. I welcome your hate in the comments. Extrapolating our data to other esports titles tells us that games like League of Legends and Dota 2 is what these chips were made for. And if you want to sit down on your couch and just play some Rocket League with friends, you'll be more than satisfied, at least with your average performance numbers. However, I was speaking with Bitwit Kyle the other day, and we were discussing our testing for these chips and how it was going. We discussed something interesting he was seeing, as I hadn't yet run most of my benchmarks, and he wanted what amounts to a sanity check and to make sure there wasn't something wrong with his bench. While average frame rates in games, especially esports titles, were impressive for an iGPU, the 1% and 0.1% lows he was seeing were atrocious, and he was getting a lot of stuttering and frame skipping. I wanted to see if I could recreate this problem on my own, so after running all of our normal canned benchmarks, I fired up Overwatch and CSGO again and did a full capture analysis, including frame times. Overwatch ran relatively smoothly, and you can see from this scatter plot that although there are some outlying data points, the 1% lows aren't going to stand out too much when your average is 41. The same held true with the 2200G in this title, but when I switched over to Counter-Strike, things took a turn for the inconsistent. There was noticeable unevenness to the gameplay on both Ryzen APUs, and this reflects in our captured data. I do have a theory or two, however. First, what we were seeing might have been a direct result of the GPU not having its own pool of dedicated memory. Frame buffers have to be drawn from system memory, and as such are competing for resources with everything else that needs to use the memory bus. As with the initial wave of Ryzen processors, it appears that AMD chips still see huge benefits from memory modules that are able to achieve 2933 MHz or faster, and unfortunately this may offset the value proposition for those looking for a relatively cheap all-in-one solution. If your processor costs $100 but you need a $200 kit of memory to take advantage of it, where is the savings exactly? The second theory is a bit less precise. It's entirely possible that this is a first-gen product with first-gen problems. Maybe the drivers aren't fully baked yet. Maybe motherboard BIOS will mature. Maybe some games just play better on NVIDIA. Right now, there's really no way to know, and AMD is mum on the situation for now. With the occasional early adopter issues aside, the Ryzen APUs spit out some totally decent numbers as long as you're not trying to play demanding AAA titles all the time. With some minor adjustments to quality settings, playable frame rates should be achievable in almost every game. However, keep in mind that your mileage may vary depending on what titles you play the most. I was seeing poor 1% and 0.1% lows in CSGO and Metro Last Light. Kyle saw the same thing in those titles and also Rocket League, which I didn't test. Most other titles seem not to suffer from this issue, at least in my limited time with the product so far. It might be worth watching and or reading as many reviews as you can, as each reviewer has a different test suite, and maybe you can find someone who tested the exact game and configuration you want to use, and has hard data on what you can expect. Something to consider, especially in this crazy GPU market right now, is that if you're building a system but can't afford a GPU due to inflated prices, buying an AMD APU as a stopgap isn't a bad solution. You can scrape along just fine initially, and then once you slap in a GTX 1070, these just become regular Ryzen 3 or Ryzen 5 processors. I want to give a big thank you to Computer Upgrade King for providing our comparison systems for today's testing. If you guys are interested in their new Axiom line, I'll drop a link down below along with a 5% discount code if you want to go check them out. They also have plenty of Intel systems, as you can see, and you can configure them any way you'd like if you'd rather stick with the Blue Team. So what did you guys think of the new Ryzen APUs? Are these processors something you'd consider, or would you rather have a discrete graphics card? Let me know down below in the comments. Also, don't forget to get subscribed to the channel if you are not already, and as always guys, thanks for watching.